Good morning.
Morning.
And welcome to worship at Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Wells, Minnesota. I'm Pastor Mary Iverson, and I serve alongside Pastor Meg Sander. And together we continue to be just so grateful for the team who helps lead our worship services. Our camera technician this morning is Gary Hagen. Andy Grosskreutz is our worship assistant. Gene Carlson is at the piano. Our singers today are John Melby and Bill Grosskreutz Jr. and Sandy Hartman. Our screeners today, those who welcome you as you arrive to worship, are Kent Stern and Tom Hansen. And I thank you all for being a part of this team that it takes for us to lead worship. We do, because we have the screeners here, we have in-person worship at this time. And we are broadcasting in many different formats. Last Sunday, we had our Good Shepherd annual meeting. After the annual meeting, the new church council gathered. They set the date for the next church council meeting, and then they elect their leadership. And the leadership that was elected includes a team led by Russ Elmer, who is the 2021 church council president. The vice president is Jeanette Grosskreutz. And Jessica Schrader is the new secretary, so they are the executive team of church council. And I invite you to keep our entire church council in your prayers as they lead our congregation forward to serve God faithfully. Ash Wednesday and Lent are quickly approaching. Ash Wednesday is February 17th. There will be an Ash Wednesday evening worship in person and broadcast at 6:15 p.m. All of our evening services, including Holy Week, will be at 6:15 p.m. Ashes are a part of our Lenten tradition. Here at Good Shepherd, they remind us that we're human, that one day we will return to dust, and reminding us just how much we need our risen Savior. Ashes will be distributed on Ash Wednesday, but just in a little different way. They will be distributed twice on Ash Wednesday. All of our ashes will be distributed outdoors in the drive-through parking lot that comes near the elevator entrance. From 1 to 1:30 in the afternoon, we'll be outside distributing ashes, and again after worship, approximately 6:45 to 7:15. We will also at that time be handing out Lenten bags that are filled with many things that we've put together to help you on your Lenten journey this year. And we'll also have some bags with communion supplies that we'll be handing out to you as well that day. So mark your calendars for February 17th, Ash Wednesday. Today, Holy Communion is served during worship, so please gather your communion supplies, your bread, your wine, your grape juice, and a Bible if you're worshiping through broadcast. And here in the church, the communion supplies were at the table as you entered. Then our final announcement is a sad one. Pastor Kathy Fullerton, who served here as pastor, died this past Thursday. She had been in hospice for a while. Our sympathy is with Kathy's four children and their families at this time. The memorial service for Pastor Kathy Fullerton will be broadcast on Facebook this coming Saturday, February 13th. Please contact Andy at the Good Shepherd Church office for information on how you can view that memorial service. And again, as I said, our prayers are with Pastor Kathy's family as they grieve her passing. Those are the announcements for today. Our worship continues with Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound
that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. I got my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing
By your goodness, you restored many people to good health, even raising the dead to life. Bring to us restoration and transformation, healing our hearts, minds, and spirits, so that we may give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture passage today, as we continue reading through the Gospel of Luke, comes to us from the 7th chapter of Luke. Soon afterwards, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went with him. As he approached the gate of the town, a man who had died was being carried out. He was his mother's only son. She was a widow. And with her was a large crowd from the town. When the Lord Jesus saw her, he had compassion for her. And he said to the woman, "Do not weep." Then he came forward and he touched the bier, the funeral cart, and the bearers stood still. Jesus said, "Young man, I say to you, rise." The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Now fear seized everyone in the crowd. They glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us." And they sang out, "God has looked favorably upon his people." Now this word about Jesus spread throughout Judea and all the surrounding country. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Thank you. from God the Father, from our Lord, from our Savior, who is Jesus the Christ. Several years ago, when my beloved Grandma Christofferson died, our family got a surprise when we arrived at the cemetery for the burial. We gathered as the pallbearers pulled the casket from the hearse, and the surprise came then as the pallbearers turned and started the walk towards the gravesite. The pastor at my grandma's church, Ron Barnett, started singing as he led us as a group from the hearse to the gravesite. It was beautiful, a beautiful surprise. It kind of reminded me of those funeral processions that I hear about down in New Orleans. Down in New Orleans, they always have a walk to the cemetery, not only with a singer, but even a jazz band leading the way, and they often sing and even dance on their way, singing, "Oh, when the saints go marching in." Pastor Ron didn't sing that song, but it was a beautiful hymn as he led us to my grandma's burial. We were glum as we approached the hearse, but as we walked to the grave behind him, as he sang out a hymn, we didn't know it, so we didn't join in the singing, but we listened to the words and we got a little bit more of a bounce in our step and a little more hope in our hearts as we prepared then to commend her or gift her back to God in burial. I tell that story today because our Bible reading is about a funeral procession. The funeral had probably already taken place, and they were journeying then from the place that the funeral service was out to the cemetery, which usually were on the outskirts of town. And I think it was a funeral procession that was filled with an awful lot of hope that day. Now, Luke, the gospel writer, tells that Jesus and his disciples and a large crowd that had gathered around him, following him, they were traveling in the northern area of the Holy Lands in a region that is now Syria, when Jesus and his group crossed paths with a funeral procession. A widow's only son was being buried that day. Her only son dead, a horrible loss in and of itself, but her husband had already died. Luke made sure we realized that. And so it's certain that the woman was grieving in many ways that day. All of her male relatives were dead, which left her, according to the ways the society was structured at that time, it left her with no one to support her. In those days, women could not own property, even if it was left to them after death, and women could not hold a job outside of the home. Women relied on men for everything financial, and so as we read this and Luke points those things out to us, that it was her only son and that her husband had already died, she was probably facing homelessness at that point, grieving the death of a husband and now a son and all of her security. Luke writes that the boy's body was on top of a bier, B-I-E-R, which is a funeral cart, as they traveled out of the town towards the cemetery. And as they came near to the gates of the city, the funeral procession then crossed paths with Jesus and the crowd he was traveling with. And Luke writes that Jesus stepped forward and approached the boy's mother. His heart was broken for her, Luke points out. Jesus said, "Don't cry." And he reached out and he touched the funeral cart. And then Jesus commanded that the dead boy get up. And the son came back to life. Can you imagine how the crowd reacted when they witnessed this miracle firsthand? Jaws dropped, to be sure. People shrieked. The mother threw her arms around her son, and the crowd started singing. Singing, I imagine, like a New Orleans jazz funeral procession. When the trumpets blared, they sang their praises out to God. They sang out, Luke writes, "A great prophet has risen among us. God is back, and he's looking after the needs of his people. Thank you, God." They cried out in song. Just hours earlier, the mother could not imagine how the day would end. She was grieving. She wondered where she would live, how she would eat, how she could survive. And now she was in the midst of this most joyous street party. It was great that the crowd celebrated, that they gave thanks to God. But I have to admit that one thing in this story confuses me. See, Jesus, he healed a lot of people in the Gospel of Luke. So many people were healed in Luke that the biblical scholars often write that the gospel writer Luke is Dr. Luke. That's what they call him oftentimes, because he focused on healing so much in his gospel. In one Luke story, a woman approached Jesus at a dinner party, and she poured perfume on the feet of Jesus. Jesus healed her. Another woman pushed through the crowds just to touch the hem of his cloak. Jesus healed her. And just before this story, a soldier sent word through friends that his servant was sick. And Jesus praised the man, and they are healed. And in all these stories, Jesus said, "Their faith has made them well." But in today's story, the grieving mother didn't even ask Jesus to raise her son from the dead. She didn't fall on her knees and beg Jesus. And there was no mention of her faith or her son's faith. All she did was cry. The mother didn't ask. Maybe she thought it was too late. She didn't say please. And afterwards, she didn't say thank you, at least not that Luke wrote about it. The son didn't even say thank you either. Luke doesn't make mention of that. And this makes me wonder. Perhaps today's story is not about faith or gratitude. Maybe it's a story about grace. Now, pure grace. Grace is defined as love from God that we don't earn and we don't even deserve. It isn't requested. That's grace, unearned, undeserved love from God. Now remember that each week as we read through this gospel, which we're doing this year, Luke is an artist for us. He's painting a picture of Jesus for us so that we can learn more about who Jesus is. And today we learn through another brushstroke in reading the 7th chapter of Luke, we learn that Jesus is a Savior who heals because he has compassion, period. He didn't heal because that woman, the mother, the grieving mother, had a strong faith. He didn't heal because that son is so grateful. Jesus healed as pure gift. The woman might have been faithful and they might have been grateful people, but Luke is clear in the story. Jesus is compassionate, period. And then he healed. So what does this teach us? I wondered about that all week. And I decided that if we follow the path of Jesus, if we act like Jesus, hospitality and basic human needs are given to others purely out of compassion. Just like Jesus. Too often it seems as if people think we should only provide things to people if they fit a proper criteria. Then suddenly they become deserving. That's not what Jesus says. Today's story reminds us that the love of God given through Jesus is pure gift, pure compassion. When grace comes into our lives, it requires nothing of us but the embrace of it or turning away from it. So I guess when we live our life as a follower of Jesus, we should always pack our party clothes, because we never know with Jesus when one of our moments of sadness might turn into a big moment of celebration, all because of the compassion of Jesus. At one funeral I attended, there was no street celebration and there was no brass band. It was a funeral for a young woman in Rice Lake, Wisconsin, who died at the young age of 34. Her father was a pastor. He grieved alongside the woman's husband and the young children, who were so sad to have lost their mother. Cancer is what took her quickly, and we gathered then for a funeral. Crowd packed the church, and as we sat there, it felt wrong. It felt wrong because young people are not supposed to die, especially young, fun-loving women like Liz. And so everyone entered the church that day weighed down by shock and by grief and deep sadness. Her father, surprisingly, started the funeral. And he said, "I need to be the one to share with you what Liz wanted for her funeral." He said, "My daughter wants hymns at her funeral. Lots and lots of songs." So the piano started playing. And first we sang "Holy, Holy, Holy." And then instead of a prayer after that, we went right into another hymn. We went into "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine." And then we went right into "How Great Thou Art." And by then, and I was sitting in the congregation that day, not up front leading it, by then the congregation, we all started kind of looking at each other, because this is not how funerals are usually held in northwestern Wisconsin. And then we started singing "Born and Cry," and by that time we were forgetting protocol and we just started singing our hearts out. And then by the time we sang the final chords of "Amazing Grace," we actually started to experience some amazing grace. Well, most of us did. Because the next day I stopped at the grocery store there in Rice Lake, and I overheard two women talking about Liz's funeral. Unconventional was one word I heard. And they clucked their tongues and they said, "Well, I have never seen a funeral like that," in kind of that normal judgmental talk that we've heard others have. And when I saw and overheard those women in the grocery store, I saw classic judgment, looking down a nose at. And then I remember the definition of grace. It comes without requesting it, often when we least expect it. We can't earn God's love. We can't work for it. We can't plead for it. It just comes. We embrace it, or, like those women in the grocery store, we scoff at it. We can sing with our arms wide open, whether we can carry a tune or not. Or we can clench our teeth and cross our arms and have cold, closed hearts. We can scoff at the wideness of God's mercy, or we can dance like nobody's watching Grace is going to come to you. I promise you that. This is a promise from God, not just from me. And it might come to you when you least expect it. And you can either throw out the welcome mat or shut the door. You can pattern your lives after a Lord who lives with wide compassion, without condition, without judgment, or you can embrace the attitude that the women had at that grocery store that day. You can build bridges or walls. If you're confused about how we are to live as children of God, reread this story sometime and see the compassion that Jesus had. Thanks be to God who creates us, who redeems us, who sustains us, and who transforms us to wholeness. Amen.
Confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Each Wednesday morning before the sun rises, or close to that time anyway, a group of men gather on Zoom on our computers to study the Bible and pray together. They are not all members of Good Shepherd. They come from various faiths. They come from various communities. Our Promise Keepers group started quite a number of years ago, and I remember one time when Pastor Dennis commented that, yes, I'll be a part of it, but I don't want to lead it. I just want to be one of the guys and be a participant. And it's fortunate that we are able to gather by Zoom now. It is a much different platform, but we gather together and we are able to share from our various communities and our various different faiths. That Bible study is prepared by our pastors, and we thank them for doing that. Just another way that your offering dollars support the pastor's salary that helps us grow in our faith. You're able to make donations by visiting the Good Shepherd website and clicking online giving. You can also put your offering in the mail and send it to the church. For those who are worshiping here in the building, you're welcome to leave your offering in the basket by the door as you depart. Thank you again for your faithful support of the ministry of Good Shepherd Lutheran Church here in Wells.
There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded.
Let us pray. Come, Lord Jesus, into the most difficult situations where you bring hope and healing, revealing that the heart of God is filled with compassion and love. Yet we are so often quick to question your graciousness. We worry and we are slow to trust in your goodness. Give us the faith to trust in your love, even during dark days. Open our eyes when you gift us with grace. Continue to shape us to be people who are grateful for your unconditional love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Come, Lord Jesus, into the lives of all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials, health organizations, and care providers, that in times of trial, fear, or hopelessness, they find freedom and service to those most in need. Give us all humble hearts, listening ears, and willing hands. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Come, Lord Jesus, into the lives of all who are wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, and for all who cry out to you, may we be balm for their wounds and ointment for their scars. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Come, Lord Jesus, bring peace to the hearts and minds of all who are hurting. Deliver them from pain, disease, and illness. We pray for Bebo Getchell, Doug Schroeder, Julie Forderer, Barb Fox, Gail Reddick, Bill Harnick, Eldo Overbow, Gordon Hansen, and Kim Kasten's. May they find healing and wholeness. We offer prayers of sympathy for the family and friends of Kathy Fullerton, who died this past week. Surround them with your comfort and care in their grief. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, receive our prayers and reveal the glory and presence of your Spirit alive in the world today. Free us from all doubts and empower us to show your love to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul.
As part of our communion liturgy, we read 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. In the mystery of Christ's resurrection, you shine light into the darkness. You give bread that nourishes your people and frees us from our fear. Help us savor the meal that promises forgiveness and life everlasting. Praying together the prayer that our Lord first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The service continues as the grains of wheat, Red Book 465. This time I invite you to serve yourself or each other communion, saying, "Body of Christ given for you, blood of Christ shed for you."
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Receive the benediction. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is, I Know That My Redeemer Lives, Red Book 619. The Lord.
Thanks be to God.